Hey everyone, and welcome back to Gaming and Catholic. I'm really happy that you guys are all here. Today is the second part in our six-part series for Story of Salvation. We have started our Bible study with the covenant that was between God and one couple, that was Adam and Eve. Today, God is going to expand that covenant from one couple to one family, and we're going to see that with Noah and the Ark. Right, let's get into it. We're going to start today's Bible study still in Genesis. We're going to start in chapter 6, verses 11 through 18. In the eyes of God, the earth was corrupt and full of lawlessness. When God saw how corrupt the earth had become since all mortals led depraved lives on earth, he said to Noah, "I have decided to put an end to all mortals on earth. The earth is full of lawlessness because of them, so I will destroy them and all life on earth. Make yourself an ark of gopher wood, put various compartments in it, and cover it inside and out with pitch. This is how you shall build it. The length of the ark shall be 300 cubits, its width 50 cubits, and its height 30 cubits. Make an opening for daylight in the ark and finish the ark a cubit above it. Put an entrance in the side of the ark, which you shall make with bottom, second, and third decks. I, on my part, am about to bring the flood waters on the earth to destroy everywhere all creatures in which there is the breath of life. But everything on earth shall perish. But with you, I will establish my covenant, you and your sons, your wife, and your sons' wives shall go into the ark." I want to start by saying something that's kind of confusing to people. A lot of people will say, "Oh my gosh, this just shows like God is so evil and mean. He killed all of these people." This is where Christians really differentiate from everyone else, basically. And that is, to God, life and death don't mean that much. They're very significant to us because we have a very finite, very materialistic view of the world. We're like, you know, my best friend is gone. You know, I can't talk to them anymore. I can't see them anymore. They're gone. And that's it. That's all I know. And it's painful. But to God, death is just something that has to happen now that sin is in the world. And he sees the after, and to the Christian, life after death is way better than life itself. And so a lot of times God will kill people, and typically this is an act of mercy because God is all-knowing and he's all-loving, and a lot of times he can see, okay, if this person continues to live their life on earth, they're going to end up in hell. And we'll talk about hell later. God doesn't send people to hell. It's a choice, but I'm going to talk about that in a whole other video. But nonetheless, if this person continues on the path that they're continuing on, they're going to end up in hell. And I don't see them, you know, changing that. And so if they die now, then they can still make it into heaven, and it's kind of an act of mercy. Now, that isn't always the case. And this is something that I don't think people understand. A lot of people are morally therapeutic deists and not actually Christians. They believe that there's just this nice guy in the sky who helps them when you're upset, and you can do whatever you want, and you'll still make it into whatever afterlife. And people typically associate this morally therapeutic deist to be Jesus, but that isn't actually consistent with the Bible or anything in church history. So the other reality is that some people choose evil their whole life, and God still loves those people and he wants them to change, but at the end of the day, you have free will, and if you choose to be evil, you choose to be evil. And some people really do choose to be evil their whole life, regardless of how many signs God sends them, how many times he tries to work in their lives, no matter how merciful he is. Sometimes people are just very stubborn in their ways. And although God taking people's lives seems really vicious, it's not. He's the creator of these people's lives, and so he has the ability to also take them away. Just like if you're an author or you have the ability to take someone's life out of your book, or if you're a painter or a drawer, an artist of any kind, you have the ability to erase someone from your portrait. And it's not out of, the difference is it's not out of hate and it's not out of malice. It's out of love, and it's just taking this creation. And typically, if it's not an act of mercy to the person, it's an act of mercy to the people around them, because that person can cause many, many other people to sin, they can cause many other people to suffer, and they can cause a lot of other issues for other people. So keep that in mind. So typically, if God sees this person is never gonna change, I know their heart fully, and nothing that I'm doing or going to do is going to change how they feel, then it could be an act of mercy towards the people around them, who they could also drag down with them and bring them into, you know, turn them from people that were good into bad people, or take neutral people into bad people, whatever it might be. So when God looks down on the earth, he sees that there's only one righteous man, and that's Noah. And so he asks Noah to build an ark because he is going to destroy the rest of creation. And then promises afterwards that he will make a covenant with Noah and his family. He also tells Noah that through him and his family, the entire human family is going to be restored. So we see later that the flood comes, and God remembers his promise to Noah, and he spares him and his family. Just a year after he makes his promise to Noah, the waters finally recede. Noah and his family are let out of the ark. So we see here God being faithful to his promise to Noah and his family. And you're going to see this consistently throughout all of scripture. When God makes a promise, God is always faithful to those promises. It's normally the humans that fail on their end. So God is kind of giving humanity this second chance, and immediately when they get off the ark, more chaos ensues. We're now going to read Genesis chapter 9, verses 18 through 28. The sons of Noah who came out of the ark were Shem, Ham, and Japheth. Ham was the father of Canaan. These three were the sons of Noah, and from the whole earth was peopled. Now Noah, a man of the soil, was the first to plant a vineyard. When he drank some of the wine, he became drunk and lay naked inside his tent. Ham, the father of Canaan, saw his father's nakedness, and he told his two brothers outside about it. Shem and Japheth, however, took a robe, and holding it on their back, they walked backwards and covered their father's nakedness. Since their faces were turned the other way, they did not see their father's nakedness. When Noah woke up from his drunkenness and learned what his youngest son had done to him, he said, "Cursed be Canaan, the lowest of slaves, shall he be to his brothers." He also said, "Blessed be the Lord, the God of Shem, let Canaan be his slave. May God expand Japheth so that he dwells among the tents of Shem, and let Canaan be his slave." Noah lived 350 years after the flood. The whole lifetime of Noah was 950 years. Then he died. Okay, once again, lots going on here. And if you aren't an ancient Jew, guess what? This probably isn't going to make that much sense to you at all. You're going to be like, wait, Canaan or Ham saw his naked father, and so he's like cursed. What? That doesn't make any sense, you know? And it doesn't. But I am going to explain to you why it does make sense in their culture and to the ancient Jews. Because this is actually a Hebrew idiom. To see your father's nakedness is a Hebrew idiom. So if you don't know Hebrew, you're not going to know what it means. To have a bit of a hint of what this means, we're going to look into the book of Leviticus for just a minute. And we're going to look at one specific chapter and verse. So if you look at Leviticus 18 verse 7, it says, "You shall not uncover the nakedness of your father's wife, It is your father's nakedness. Okay? Now you still might be a little confused. So I'm actually going to read from the New American Bible Translation because I think that will clarify a little bit more what's going on in this passage. Leviticus chapter 18, verse 7 from the New American Bible Translation. You shall not disgrace your father by having intercourse with your mother. She is your own mother. You shall not have intercourse with her. In other words, Ham raped his mother. While Noah was passed out drunk. Okay? In ancient times, this rape would have been considered a power play. It was actually relatively common in their culture. That does not mean that it was moral. We're against cultural relativism, right? This rape would have been a power play against his family. This would have been him trying to establish dominance in his family as the man of the household. We also see this in chapter 16 of the second book of Samuel, when Absalom rebels against David, and in order to usurp his father's kingship, he sleeps with David's concubines. So in the same way, Ham's sin was an act of rebellion against his father and his older brother Shem, because Shem was the firstborn, thus the recipient of the father's blessing. When Noah awakens and realizes what has happened, he realizes he can't curse Ham because Ham has been blessed by God through the covenant that was just established. So instead he curses Canaan, which is an interesting move because Canaan hasn't been born yet. So it's possible that Canaan, who is the father of the Canaanites and an enemy to the Israelites, is actually the son of Noah's wife who was conceived during the rape of Ham. This sin has disastrous consequences the rest of the Old Testament. It's also going to show us that sin has consequences that go beyond ourselves. Even our private sins can have long-lasting impacts on those around us. So there are a couple of things that are going awry here. Ham isn't the only one who sinned. We first see that Noah was actually the first one to sin by getting drunk. And I'm going to explain why in the Catholic Church getting drunk is a sin. And it goes hand in hand with what I talked about last Bible study. So if you haven't watched that, I ask that you do, because this is going to make more sense. If you remember that one of the ways that God made us in his image and likeness was by giving us our intellect and our will, that those separate us from all the other animals, and it's a huge gift. We're the only people, the only part of creation that's made in the image and likeness of God. And so when you're drunk, you deny those gifts because you basically shut off your intellect and your will, and it's basically a rejection of those gifts. And so it's a huge sin against God. In the Catholic Church, it's called a mortal sin. And I'll talk about the difference between mortal and venial sin in a later video. But that is why drunkenness is viewed as a sin, because you turn away from the gifts, these beautiful gifts that God gave us of our intellect and will, and you degrade yourself and make yourself like an animal that does not have an intellect and a will. And you reject the gift being made in the image and likeness of God, something that he didn't have to do for us. The next sin that we see is actually also from Noah. Because he was drunk, Noah failed on his responsibility to be the protector of the family. Noah should have been there to protect his wife from the rape of Ham. And had he been cognizant and alert, he would have been able to do that. And we actually see this in the first Bible study as well. When God gives Adam the command to work the garden, one of those words that he uses is shamar. And shamar means to protect. The male role that God gives is the protector. And so, first kind of sin of humanity, people think that it's eating of the tree of knowledge of good and evil. But the first sin was actually Adam's choice not to guard the garden. If Adam had been doing his job as protector and watcher over the garden, he would have seen the snake enter. And so it's possible that he even did see the snake enter and was too cowardly to confront the snake. And so that was where things really started to fall apart. Adam wasn't doing his role to shamar and protect. And Noah here is doing the same thing. He is not doing his role to shamar and protect his family and his wife. And so then the third sin right after was Ham being able to do his incestuous rape, which is a huge sin. So this is why I don't recommend if you're new to the Bible, just picking it up and reading it on your own. Even if you translate the words from Hebrew and Greek into English yourself, you're still gonna have a whole lot of trouble with just basic things like idioms. You would have no clue that this is what that meant. We're now gonna go back a little bit and read just slightly before this, when God actually goes ahead and establishes his covenant with Noah and his family in Genesis chapter 9, verses 13 through 17. I set my bow in the clouds to serve as a sign of the covenant between me and the earth. When I bring clouds over the earth and the bow appears in the clouds, I will recall the covenant I have made between me and you and all the living beings, so that the waters shall never again become a flood to destroy all mortal beings. As the bow appears in the clouds, I will see it and recall the everlasting covenant that I have established between God and all living things, all mortal creatures that are on earth. God told Noah, "This is a sign of the covenant I have established between me and all mortal creatures that are on the earth." Even though humanity is still sinful, God is still faithful. And that's something to remember. We consider Noah a patriarch of the Christian faith, as we consider Adam and Eve also patriarch and matriarch of the Catholic faith. They weren't perfect. They sinned. But God still remains faithful to them. In the first covenant that we saw between Adam and Eve, it was the Sabbath. That was the sign of the covenant. In this covenant between Noah and his family, we see the sign of the covenant being the rainbow, which is very interesting. We see that the family unit is very tied with the symbol of the rainbow in the Bible. And so it's very interesting how society is kind of hijacking the rainbow, calling it pride, which is what caused Satan, was the sin of Satan, of Lucifer. And it's kind of an inverse of the family, which is interesting. I will also later talk about all the hot topic button issues of the Catholic Church, same-sex attraction, birth control, pornography, sex before marriage, all of those things that people want to know about. Those are all actually very much tied together, and I'm going to talk about all of them in a video to come. Also, something that is very interesting is that there are 7 colors in the rainbow, and if you remember from our previous Bible study, you'll remember that 7 is from to seven oneself, which is to form a covenant with someone. So something that we are able to see on a semi-regular basis, the rainbow in the sky, as a reminder of the covenant that God established between himself and his people. We have probably seen the effects of sin in our own family lives. This is something that is not new, but we do get to see that even though humanity chooses evil many of the times, God still remains faithful and still loving to his creation, and he is trying his best to reveal himself to humanity that we might come to know and love him fully. And so even when we're sinful, and even when we choose not God, he is always there. He is never the one that leaves. He is always the one that fulfills his promises. It is typically our responsibility and our shortcomings and our failings and our choices that take us away from God, and not vice versa. As we move forward in this Bible study, we're going to continue to see that these patriarchs of the faith were not anywhere near perfect, because neither are we. But as many have said before, God doesn't call the qualified, he qualifies the called. And our role is not necessarily to be perfect every time, because chances are we're not going to hit that. But the goal is to strive for perfection. When we fail, to get back up on our feet, to acknowledge that what we did is wrong instead of trying to justify it as right, and to promise to go to the sacrament of confession, to repent of our sin, and to go forward and try to sin no more. And if we fall again, we get back up and we do that process over again. That's the way of the saint. The way of the saint is not being perfect 100% of the time, all the time. It's getting knocked down and getting back up again with a new renewed resolution that you're not gonna fall again, even if you do fall again. You gotta keep trying. But you can't repent of your sins if you're not going to face them as they are and acknowledge them as sins, which is a hard thing to do, but so is being a Christian. It's a hard thing to do. Anyway, I hope that you guys had a great Bible study. This one's a little bit shorter for today. I hope that you were able to learn a lot. If you're having any questions or difficulty understanding anything or want further clarification, you can email me at keepingitcatholicask@gmail.com, and I will do my best to respond to those. It may come up why I don't have comments enabled on my videos, and the reason that that is because I'm not trying to be an influencer. I'm really just trying to allow people greater access to information. I don't think it's widely accessible in the sense that people know what they don't know. That's really all that I'm trying to do, is to help people know more about their own faith, or people that don't know about the faith actually know what the real faith is instead of hearing it from other people. That is often incorrect, and that they're able to do with that information what they please. I'm not trying to be an influencer. I'm not trying to gain a mass following or whatever. I really don't care about that. This is just one hobby of mine, and it's not my actual vocation and what I'm doing on a day-to-day basis. That being said, I hope that you guys have a great rest of your week. I hope that you have a great rest of your day. I will be praying for you. I hope that you will do the same for me. And I will talk to you guys next time.